He is actually the founding member of the Mayo Clinic CSF Dynamics program. And we've had lots of collaborations. I send lots of patients to see him. He's also collaborates across multiple departments to advance understanding and treatment of low and high CSF pressure disorders. So Jeremy, take it away for us.
Thank you so much, Linda. Indeed, it's been great to get to know you and other members of our growing community here. And I have the privilege of being one of the neurologists at Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota, who works in the CSF Dynamics Clinic and leads that. And I'm going to focus today on the diagnosis of spontaneous intracranial hypotension. And I've subtitled it The Challenging But Critical First Step. And hopefully I'll make clear today to you all why I think it is important to approach this systematically. I don't have any disclosures. Over the course of these next 20 minutes, I hope to give you all an ability to describe the evolution of understanding of low CSF pressure syndrome, recognize some of the limitations of current diagnostic criteria for SIH, and finally to outline a systematic approach to spinal CSF leak diagnosis. I really can't do what I do or go further in today's talk without acknowledging the team. And we really do take a team approach here. And it all started with Bara Mokri, who I'll mention again a little bit later, but who really was a mentor to most of the folks who are named on this screen. And I think a valued friend and collaborator with a lot of other people on the call today as well. Unfortunately, he passed in 2017, but before that happened, he put together a group of neurosurgeons, neuro-ophthalmologists, anesthesia pain medicine experts, and a team of neuroradiologists that just expands every year. These are all interventionalists who do myelograms, blood patches, and other things for us. And in the neurology group, I've got three other headache specialists, as well as an excellent nurse, Melissa Payne. So I just want to acknowledge them because, again, what we do is we do as a team. We're also excited, excuse me, to be celebrating the 30th anniversary of really a landmark description, which was linking diffuse pachymeningeal enhancement on MRI with low pressure headache. And I'll talk about how a bit how that came about or where that was along the historical timeline. So talking about the evolution of our understanding, a number of dates are important, I think, just to put us in context. So we can go back 130 years to when Quincke introduced the lumbar puncture. And it wasn't long after then that Beer described the postural puncture headache. And clearly today we're talking about spontaneous spinal CSF leaks. So it's not the same as a postural puncture headache. But I think that recognition of a syndrome of orthostatic headache following invasion of the dura was an important early step. 1938, Shelton Brand coined this term aliquorrhea for the clinical syndrome of very low CSF opening pressures with headache generally. Dr. Woltman, who was a former chair of our department, linked the orthostatic headache with the spontaneous low pressure and said, again, what seems obvious now, but wasn't necessarily then, this may resemble postural puncture headache. Fast forwarding to 1991 is when Mokri and Sable reported that diffuse pachymeningeal enhancement, a new biomarker for this syndrome that up to that point was exclusively defined by the low CSF pressure. Reversible brain sag was shown a couple of years later. In the late 1990s, I think an important conceptual evolution occurred, and that was to say that this isn't just about pressure, it's probably more about volume. And part of doing that was when Dr. Mokri defined several different forms of what is now called spontaneous intracranial hypotension. You know, there was the classic form with headache and pachymeningeal enhancement and low pressure and maybe brain sag on MRI. There's also a normal pressure form that had the other features, a normal meninges form, and a headache-free or acephalgic form. Clearly, when you have more ways to define a disorder, you can recognize more patterns or phenotypes of that disorder. So then from there, we have seen a number of important conceptual advances. Early 2000s, development of hyperdynamic CT myelogram to localize fast CSF leaks. We'll hear more about those later. Linking that kind of leak in general to superficial siderosis, which is a disabling progressive neurologic syndrome. Dr. Shivink, who of course, is the wonderful host of our meeting today, was part of the group who described the first cases of CSF venous fistulas, which have exploded in terms of our recognition of a huge subset of this population. You know, it's a perhaps the most common cause of spinal CSF leakage. A couple years ago, Tomas DeBrocky and crew in Bern described a scoring system for brain MRI that I think has helped spread awareness and also given a way to quantify some of the things that we're dealing with. And I'll just make a brief mention here because I know Dr. Brinjicci is speaking later today about a novel treatment for CSF venous fistulas. This is by far not an exhaustive list of all the things that have happened in the leak world, but just a couple of time points, I think, that highlight how it really has come forward since that initial description in 1891 of the lumbar puncture. Part of the consequence is that there are a lot of names, and I'll try not to switch between them too much today, but spontaneous spinal CSF leak tends to cause a syndrome most commonly referred to as spontaneous intracranial hypotension, but there are limitations to that, because I already said it's not always about pressure. In fact, perhaps it's very little about pressure. So there's low CSF volume, headache, CSF hypovolemia, CSF volume depletion. We're getting all at the same concept. So we'll hear more about that today, and emphasizing that it is different from the postdural puncture headache, even though some of the symptoms certainly overlap. We are celebrating, I suppose, the anniversary plus one day of the new codes for that relate to intracranial hypotension. And Dr. DeLine and a number of others on this call certainly deserve a lot of credit for pushing the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services to recognize this important recognition of intracranial hypotension and how it needs proper coding to advance patient care, research, insurance coverage, all those things. So here's just a couple of those codes if you haven't heard about them yet. Let's get into the meat of the talk now by recognizing some of the limitations of the current diagnostic criteria for SIH. So one of the earlier sets of criteria was an expert diagnostic publication that said this syndrome, SIH, is orthostatic headache and at least one of the following. You could demonstrate active spinal CSF leakage, you could see it, or you could document low CSF opening pressure below 60 millimeters of water, or you could show that the MRI of the brain was abnormal with brain sag or effective meningeal enhancement, or back then at least there was the idea that response to a blood patch might be a diagnostic criterion. Now there are limitations to all of these things, and this is not a critique saying that these are bad criteria, just that they're incomplete and have gone through some changes since, right? So of course, we recognize not every patient has a headache. At least half of patients have normal opening pressure. MRI is not abnormal in every patient. And if you're doing an invasive procedure, there's going to be a large placebo effect. And so basing the diagnosis on response to a procedure that probably is going to improve a lot of people's symptoms, even if it doesn't change anything else physiologically, is a shifting sands of diagnostic criteria, I would say. So in 2018, the most recent version of the ICHD-3 still required headache. These are headache criteria and low pressure or the MRI brain abnormalities or and the headache, of course, had to come in temporal relationship along with the low pressure or CSF leakage. So this is an improvement, but still has basically those same limitations that not everyone has a headache, pressure isn't always abnormal, MRI isn't always abnormal. And I think Dr. Scheibink has described just a slight modification that's a very important advance in that, yes, we can use brain MRI stigmata, we can use spine imaging showing CSF leakage, we can use pressure, but recognize that headache isn't always the issue. And so if the symptoms are still best explained by intracranial hypotension, we can call that spontaneous intracranial hypotension. I don't want to get to seem like I'm arguing semantics too much, but what I hope to convey is that there's no one test that makes the diagnosis. You have to have a strong clinical suspicion, and the rest of the talk is going to focus on maybe how would we think about that as we come up with that clinical suspicion? What are we going to do? So the rest of the time is that systematic approach. I take this approach, which is that recognizing, I think the diagnosis of spinal CSF leak requires sequentially answering these three questions. Is there an active leak? If so, is it fast, slow, or fistula? And then where is it? Of course, we all are most interested in question three, where's the leak? But it's like finding a needle in a haystack. And if we don't even know there's a needle in that haystack, we're going to waste a lot of time, put patients through potentially invasive, not necessarily unsafe, but uncomfortable procedures. And I think we ought to do that because we know there's a leak to be found. So I'll give you a couple of particular patient stories. This was a 40-year-old woman who I saw not too long ago for new daily persistent headache. She described it as a bifrontal and occipital pressure that was worse when she stood up, also worse with cough, strains, knees, lap, bending forward, variety of Valsalva maneuvers. She had orthostatic nausea and distorted hearing. Her exam was normal, other than the fact that she had some joint hypermobility. And I'll show you the Biten scale in a minute, but her score, you can keep in mind, was 4 out of 9. So modestly elevated. So to that first question, does this patient have an active spinal CSF leak? I think we can think about it in terms of, does she have common symptoms of that? Does she have risk factors for that? And then does she have an MRI abnormalities to support that diagnosis? And Dr. Friedman is going to give us much more on the clinical syndromes. So I don't want to steal her thunder at all, other than to say the common symptoms are the ones that you've all heard about many times, an orthostatic headache, orthostatic nausea, are right there at the top of the list, just like this patient had. So yeah, she had common symptoms. What about risk factors? Well, a few risk factors have been described, joint hypermobility, top among them. Sometimes that amounts to a full connective tissue disorder diagnosis like Marfan syndrome or the Ehlers-Danlos syndromes, but not always. Disc osteophytes, little razor blades in the spine can cut through the dura. So those are risk factors, although we have to recognize that there are a lot of disc osteophytes in people who do not have spinal CSF leakage. So simply finding an osteophyte is not enough. Intracranial hypertension, kind of the opposite end of the spectrum, usually presents with papilledema and headache and pulse synchronous tinnitus, but sometimes the pressure gets released through the spine, through a spinal leak. So the leak is actually secondary to a high pressure disorder. So we have to keep that in mind. I'd say not common, but certainly have seen some cases, and in talking to others on the call, I know that other people have suspected this as well. Bariatric surgery has been linked here. Some reports say low BMI is a risk factor. Some reports say high BMI is a risk factor. And I think mechanism is maybe a little less clear here, but at least that's something to keep in mind as we're talking about patients and trying to help them. And finally, trauma, often minor. Often there's no inciting event. People just say, headache started one day. I don't know what I did to cause it. I tell patients, it's probably nothing you did. It just happened. But sometimes there's trauma, and it's important to know that because maybe that gives you a hint at what part of the spine to start looking at. So again, back to that 40-year-old lady with a new daily persistent headache. She had common symptoms. She had risk factors. So the next question, of course, is what does her MRI look like? And here it is. Here's MRI brain with gadolinium contrast. And we have several talks later today that are really going to go into the details of the imaging abnormalities. So I'll just show a few as a first pass, but I'll leave it to others to talk about what causes these specifically or how to measure them in certain cases. But what you're seeing here is a descent to the cerebellar tonsils, which is not a specific sign. Right? There are other things that can make the cerebellum go down. Obliteration of the prepontine cistern with flattening of that ventral pons, enlargement of the pituitary gland, descent or flattening of the optic chiasm, which results in a small suprasellar cistern. There's a reduced mammalopontine distance. There's the engorgement of the venous sinuses. There's, of course, the diffuse, smooth, non-nodular pachymeningeal enhancement, dural enhancement. Key thing being, it is not leptomeningeal. This is not an enhancement that creeps down into the sole side of the brain, but rather sticks right around the outer edge. It's the dura enhancing, not other layers. There are other signs, and again, I'll leave it to others to talk about it, but this patient had the symptoms. She had the risk factors, she had the MRI abnormalities, and even though MRI is not abnormal in every patient, it was in her. So she seems to have a leak. We haven't shown it yet. We don't know where it is other than in the spine, but we have, I think, made a strong case that there is a leak to be found here. Tomas Dobrocki and his team published this, screening algorithm or scoring system for brain MRI that has been taken up by a lot of us in the field in terms of judging by how abnormal an MRI scan is, how likely it is to find a leak. And it's exactly that. It's not a score of, does this patient have a leak? And I think it's sometimes used that way. It's how likely am I to find a leak on subsequent spinal imaging? Because the more abnormal the brain is, what's been shown in both the Dobrocki cohorts and ours is that more brain abnormalities make it more likely to find something in the spine. And that group in Bern did not have any CSF venous fistulas. Ours, where we were relying on digital subtraction myelogram to identify the patients, was largely CSF venous fistulas. But that correlation of higher score two more likely to find a leak held up in both cohorts. Again, it's not a diagnostic score, but rather a predictor of subsequent imaging findings. It doesn't catch every patient though. So here's a different lady, 41-year-old woman who had monthly migraines. So she had premorbid headaches, but they came daily orthostatic. So a very clear character and pattern change. She would hear echoes, see black spots. So she had a couple of other symptoms, and her headaches were worse with bending forward, worse with other Valsalva maneuvers, and worse late in the day. She could lie down. She didn't have to fall asleep, but she could get some relief with recumbency. Here's her MRI. There's no brain sag. There's no pachymeningeal enhancement. So even though she seemed to have common symptoms of SIH, she didn't have any risk factors, didn't have any cranial MRI signs. Does she have a leak? Well, I would say that's not quite enough, but that doesn't mean it's the end of the road. And I'm going to take a little detour here to talk about the Monroe-Kelly doctrine, which basically talks about the various contents of the head. Right? There's this assumption that the cranial compartment is incompressible, the volume inside it's fixed, right? We've got a skull, we've got a certain amount of space inside of it. And that space contains brain tissue, blood, and cerebrospinal fluid. And they're in some sort of state of volume equilibrium. An increase in one constituent has to be compensated by a decrease in another if the pressure is going to stay the same. And the correlate to that then, of course, is that a decrease in volume of one constituent, such as spinal fluid, must be compensated by an increase in volume of another. I suppose you could grow more brain to take up the space of the missing spinal fluid, but that doesn't tend to happen. Instead, the venous or bloody structures tend to expand. Pituitary, subdural fluid collections, the meninges themselves, and the venous sinuses. So with that in mind, it actually becomes easy to understand what's causing all the various MRI brain abnormalities, and they are volume compensation mechanisms. Or when those mechanisms fail, the brain sinks. So across the bottom are just the various things you saw on that prior patient's MRI. And I'm telling you that all of these result from a lack of volume, not necessarily from a lack of pressure. And so if we keep that in mind, we can use not an MRI, but a different type of test to perhaps support the diagnosis of SIH. So that test is a radioisotope cisternogram, and they don't look necessarily at pressure. They look at flow. And these are all on the left side of the screen, normal findings. So basically what happens is a radionuclide tracer is injected through a standard lumbar puncture, and then pictures are taken periodically thereafter to see it diffuse up through the spinal fluid towards the head. You know, usually makes it into the head a few hours later, makes it up and over the top of the cerebral convexities by 24 hours in every normal patient. And there are a number of ways to suspect that a patient has a leak because of abnormalities on the cisternogram. So perhaps you see accumulation of tracer in the paraspinal space. And that could just be a large meningeal nerve root sleeve diverticulum, but it could also be the site of the leak. Perhaps most helpful is the reduced tracer activity over the cerebral convexities at 24 hours. Because again, tracer should have made it to the top within a day. When it doesn't, while I don't know where the leak is, it's somewhere along the spine. Some patients, you see that tracer get into the systemic circulation and you can see the whole body, what we call the silhouette sign. And you can see on that same image, complete lack of tracer in the head, not just over the convexities, but around the brain at all. And finally, we can see early tracer activity in the bladder in some cases. If it's there within 4 hours, that's too quickly. And it implies that there's an abnormal connection or at least leakage of spinal fluid that's letting that tracer get into the bloodstream. All right, so I provide that as background to then show you the cisternogram from that 41-year-old woman who had very clear symptoms suggestive of a spinal CSF leak, but normal brain MRI. Her opening pressure was 190, robustly normal, but she had early activity in the bladder. She had reduced activity, almost no activity in the head at 24 hours. She had a faint silhouette sign. You can perhaps just make out her arms and torso here. So she had, yes, common symptoms, no risk factors, no MRI abnormalities. She did not have low opening pressure, but she had cisternographic signs. And I would say in our experience that cisternogram, while we don't do it in every patient because it's more invasive than an MRI, we have yet to find a leak in someone whose MRI was normal and cisternogram was normal. So flipping that, I think cisternogram becomes roughly 100% sensitive for leaks that are subsequently found. I'm very much open to the possibility that there are leaks in people who have both normal MRI and normal cisternogram. But so far, we haven't found a myelographic technique to find those. So I'll get close to wrapping up here by just summarizing the various ways one can find identify evidence to make the diagnosis of SIH. There's direct evidence. You can observe the CSF escaping the thecal sac at surgery. You could observe the contrast escaping the thecal sac on a myelogram. That might be MR myelogram, CT myelogram, digital subtraction myelogram, lots of options that we'll hear about over the course of the day. But any of those where you actually directly observe CSF or contrast escaping where you put it would be pretty good evidence of a leak. Or on an MRI spine, seeing extradural CSF, seeing a big pocket of fluid in the spine bed outside the dural sac. Indirectly, and this is what we're mostly reliant on, there are the cranial MRI abnormalities, the dural enhancement, venous engorgement, brain sag, subdural fluid collections. As I said earlier, measuring lumbar puncture opening pressure is helpful if it's low, not so much if it's normal, but low pressure is indirect evidence. Maybe you've got sequential pressure measurements of someone's CSF opening pressure and it's gone down. That could be indirect evidence of leakage. The hyperdense paraspinal vein sign has been described on various types of myelograms as suggestive of a CSF venous fistula, but it is not perfect. It's not always there. And in fact, sometimes it's a false positive. I just talked about cisternography, and so reduced tracer over the convexities at 24 hours is a helpful sign. Early activity in the bladder is a helpful sign. I did not talk about, but I'll just mention here, doing a CT scan early after a myelogram, capturing the kidneys and seeing contrast in the kidneys implies that CSF escaped from the contrast escaped from the CSF into the bloodstream and got to the kidneys and then the bladder early. And from those early diagnostic criteria, you know, some would argue that response to epidural patching is indirect evidence of CSF leakage, but an important caveat there that there's going to be a placebo effect. And not every patch works, of course. So reminding you of the kind of the sequential questions, again, I focus mostly on number one, is there an active CSF leak? Then we can move on to the other two. And I'm just going to flash through two slides to say, how do we answer the other two? At Mayo Clinic, we tend to do the MRI head, if necessary, the cisternogram, followed by MRI the entire spine, basically to separate patients who do have a spinal longitudinal extradural CSF collection from those who don't. And if they do, we call that a fast leak, and we're going to typically do a prone hyperdynamic CT myelogram. Whereas if they don't have the spinal longitudinal extradural CSF, we will do a digital subtraction myelogram in lateral decubitus position. And that finds both slow leaks or fistulas in the majority of cases. There are other ways to get to the end result. So Dr. Farb in Toronto published this way forward, and it works well too. And that's all reliant on DSM, but doing the scan either prone, if there is a longitudinal extradural CSF collection, or lateral decubitus, if not. And we haven't adopted the prone DSM largely because our surgeons just like to know which side to approach from and where they're more likely to see the leak. And doing cross-sectional imaging with CT allows that information. But of course, the practice evolves. And these are both, I think, valid approaches. I hope that over the last few minutes, I've given you, again, some ability to describe the evolution or understanding of how we've come to approach low CSF pressure syndrome, recognizing some of the limitations of our current diagnostic criteria and really what drives us to keep moving forward, and having at least one systematic approach in mind to making a spinal CSF leak diagnosis. We're going to have a Q&A panel later, so I will stop my share and relinquish the remainder of my time and look forward to hearing from you all later.